The universe is stranger than we imagine. According to our understanding of physics, it doesn't make sense. Scientists have explored many ways to explain it, leading to some crazy-sounding ideas. Over an extremely large but not infinite amount of time, by sheer chance, atoms in a void could spontaneously come together in such a way as to assemble a functioning human brain. This would be a brain that would, in all respects, think and feel just as a human brain. Yes, you heard that right. This hypothetical brain is referred to as a Boltzmann brain. And while a human brain floating there in the void may sound absurd, it's a question that has troubled many great minds because such an outcome is theoretically possible. According to Brian Greene, there could be a brain floating in space that just happens to have a particle configuration exactly as your brain. The probabilistic nature of quantum physics with the combination of virtually unlimited time can yield to such an outcome.
Boltzmann brain is a very curious idea, and what you recognize is that the combination of virtually unlimited time together with the probabilistic nature of the quantum laws yields a very potent combination. Because a quantum mechanics says that something can happen even with an incredibly small probability if you wait long enough. You're virtually assured that that unlikely event will at some point happen. And when it comes to the nature of thought, the most probable, although incredibly unlikely event that the universe allows to happen is that the particles that are floating through the void, every so often, a couple then can smash into each other and stick together, or through the energy of their collision, create a new particle. And every so often, a third particle can come in. Sometimes they'll fall apart, but sometimes it'll happen again. If you wait long enough, one of the processes that can happen is particles can just randomly come together to yield a brain. A brain that can be imprinted by virtue of the particle arrangement with the very thoughts that you or I currently possess.
The Boltzmann brain argument suggests that it is more likely for a single brain to spontaneously and briefly form in a void, complete with a false memory of having existed in our universe, than it is for the universe to have come about as the result of a random fluctuation in a universe in thermal equilibrium. In addition, in many theories about the universe, human brains appear to be vastly less likely than Boltzmann brains will be in the future. This leads to the conclusion that, statistically, human brains are likely to be Boltzmann brains.
So this is a curious idea. What's really disturbing about it is if you ask yourself, or if I ask you perhaps, like, where did your brain come from? But I think most of us would give an account that would say, look, I was born, and my parents, they were born, and you'd sort of trail it all the way back, perhaps even go back to the Big Bang. And that's an interesting story. But here's the thing. The number of brains that can be created in that conventional manner is relatively small compared to the number of brains that can form in the void if you're waiting for an effectively infinite amount of time. So if you ask yourself, by sheer dint of probabilities, are you one of those brains that formed in that very rare process, which started at the Big Bang and yielded the brain in the manner that you've described, or is it more likely that you're one of those brains that's floating in the void? And since there's so many more of those compared to the conventional approach, the odds would suggest that it's more likely that you are a brain floating in the void who just told a very quaint and beautiful story about starting at the Big Bang and being born in the traditional human manner, but a story that's completely false.
The idea is named after Austrian physicist Ludwig Boltzmann, who, in 1896, published a theory that tried to account for the fact that humans find themselves in a universe that is not as chaotic as the budding field of thermodynamics seemed to predict. He offered several explanations, one of them being that the universe, even one that is fully random or at thermal equilibrium, would spontaneously fluctuate to a more ordered or low entropy state. Boltzmann invoked the anthropic principle to explain why we wouldn't find ourselves in one of the very common equilibrium phases. In equilibrium, life cannot exist. Clearly, what we want to do is find the most common conditions within such a universe that are hospitable to life. Or, if we want to be more careful, perhaps we should look for conditions that are not only hospitable to life, but hospitable to the particular kind of intelligent and self-aware life that we like to think we are. In an entirely random universe, our brains should be at equilibrium with the rest of the surroundings. Since high entropy is synonymous with high disorder, our brains should be degenerating and slowly breaking down. Yet, we humans manage to grow old with a functioning brain, remember things, and gain knowledge throughout our lives. Our brains don't seem to be at equilibrium with the rest of our environment, much like everything else in our universe. While the first law of thermodynamics states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, but only altered in form, the second law of thermodynamics says that the entropy of a closed system always increases. Since the universe that we know of is a closed system, we would expect the entropy to increase over time. This means that given enough time, the most likely state of the universe is one where everything is in thermodynamic equilibrium. But we clearly don't exist in a universe of this type, since, after all, there is order all around us in various forms, not the least of which is the fact that life exists. Many scientists think that there is some yet-to-be-revealed error in present physics theories that could explain our existence. One has to bear in mind that the second law of thermodynamics about the increase in entropy is not a law in the conventional sense of law.
The second law of thermodynamics should really be called the second tendency of thermodynamics, the second overwhelming likelihood of thermodynamics, because it's a probabilistic statement that says it's overwhelmingly likely that if particles are seeded out to the world, they will evolve in a manner that increases their entropy. But that tendency can be violated, right? I mean, if I take a handful of 100 pennies and I throw them on the floor, we all know that it's highly likely that it'll be roughly 50 heads or 50 tails in that grouping. We also know, however unlikely, that it could turn out that they're all heads. We wouldn't want to bet on it. We wouldn't want to hold our breath waiting for it to happen. But that move toward order, that move toward low entropy is not in some sense in violation of the laws of physics. It's just highly unlikely. And similarly, the move toward order in the universe is just an unlikely move. It's not one that the laws of physics prevent.
According to Brian Greene, you can have pockets of order forming within the overall tendency toward disorder.
So even if we do reach this state that looks like maximal entropy of particles filling the void, much as we're talking about with the Boltzmann brains, those particles can, like the pennies, they can do the analog of landing all heads. If we wait long enough, the pennies will land all heads. If we wait long enough, some structure, however unlikely, however much it violates the second law of thermodynamics, will happen. So you never reach a state of ultimate stasis where absolutely nothing can happen. You reach a state where it's increasingly unlikely for things to happen, where the time scales for those unlikely things gets longer and longer.
But if the Boltzmann argument is right, then all we think we know and experienced didn't really happen. Your sense of self is just a statistical fluctuation in a Boltzmann brain in the future. You most likely came into being by fluctuation in this instant, so your memory watching this video is just as fabricated as every other memory.
The disturbing quality of that conclusion is, take my brain, imagine it's now actually formed in the void. That brain thinks it understands the laws of physics, quantum mechanics and general relativity, because that brain seems to remember having taken quantum mechanics and general relativity and seems to recall looking at all the data that confirm those theories, but all that's fake. All of it's false because the brain just came together right now. So that brain now can't trust anything at all. So this sort of skeptical nightmare that happens, the brain can't even trust the very reasoning that led us to conclude that the brain should form. So you've undercut all rationality when you allow these Boltzmann brains into the story. So we physicists tend to use this possibility as a diagnostic tool, that if our theories allow for this to happen, we have to find some means of dealing with that conclusion or modifying the equation so it can happen in order that we don't ruin rationality itself.
In case the idea of Boltzmann turns out to be wrong, there is still a chance that indeed this reality we perceive is not actually real. A somewhat similar example to the Boltzmann brain paradox is the simulation hypothesis, which according to Dr. Greene is the most radical of them all. But we will dedicate a whole video to this topic. Thanks for watching. Did you like this video? Then show your support by subscribing and ringing the bell to never miss videos like this.